That song tells the commission just
flat out.
No, we stand the budget now. Two oh five.
I searched the world.
Opportunity. You know, I think we could honor a man of God tonight.
Anybody else wants to share something that you want to tell Dr. Herb or Miss Vicki tonight? You'll have that opportunity. You'll have a minute to think about it, because I'm gonna tell the deepest story what I got. I'm gonna just be transparent tonight. Dr. Herb was director of missions in this area for a long time. And when you're a pastor, that's the closest thing you have to a pastor, hopefully. It's not always that way, Dr. Herb. Dr. Herb was my pastor, very faithful pastor. And in some ways, I'm a little embarrassed to say it, but in other ways, not really, just to be honest with you. I got depressed. Have any of y'all ever got depressed?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Man, I'm telling you, I was down. I could not see up. I'm telling you. I was down. Nearly down for the count. You know, I would never quit, never give up, never give out, never give in. But I was depressed. And so I was like, well, I got to talk to somebody. So I went to Dr. Herb. And, man, he blessed me that day. I think I blessed him accidentally. You asked me at one point, you probably don't remember this, you asked me at one point, you said, well, you need to do something that makes you happy. And I said, what is it? You like fish, huh? I said, you know what makes me the happiest is to just go out with my wife. Go out and eat dinner, go to the show or something. I love to go out and date my wife. And, he almost teared up. He said, I wish all my pastors said that. He said, man, how do you do that? I said, about once a week. He said, you didn't do that last week. So I did for a while. We had a date. I went home and I told my wife, that's a good way to get a date right there. The doctor said, last week, baby. Last week, girl, it's you and me, we're going to hook up. And, man, you just got me through that. And it was an honor. The only pastor I've had since I was a teenager is you. And it was an honor, absolute honor, to come to Cowboy Church and to hear you preach and to be with you. And it's an honor, sir, to have you here tonight. And it's an honor to have you, man. Anybody got a word? Anybody got a word? I know I'm putting you on the spot. I know you're nervous as a cat in a ring full of rocking chairs. How's that for a cowboy
impression?
Yes, ma'am.
Well, I've already told him that when I die, he's going to preach my sermon. And now he has to come back from Texas.
There you go.
Because yeah. I'm going to go
for you. Come back from a lot further than that.
Yes, ma'am, Miss Cindy.
I just know what he has done for me.
Yeah.
In the past, him and Miss Vicki.
Yeah.
They've always been there.
Ooh.
I'm so glad to see them.
I can't
think of enough, but they've got me back on the right track.
Yeah, you may. I saw how happy you were to see them.
That was a blessing.
I was really thankful.
That was a blessing.
Not
that I was really down and out.
Yeah.
That depressed thing.
Yeah.
Maybe I still ain't able to get in there, but I'll be all right.
That's right.
God's got me now. So you're
amazing. So it's really great. I'm going to stand up looking in the eye.
Yeah, that'd be good. Three rows back.
I know where he is. I've never seen that youth in that. Brother Herb, I told Brother Steve the other night, I was converted when I was 12 years old. I've heard a lot and lot and lot of preachers. Lots of sermons. My mother brought me to church every time the door was. But folks, let me tell you, this man is a doctor.
Amen.
Got his doctorate degree. How many doctors do you know, people who've got their doctorate degree, will come out here, get hot and sweaty in a rodeo arena, all hate, helped him haul a bunch of hay one time. He never shirked, he never backed up, he was right in there with us. What I appreciate about you most, Brother Herb, is the fact that you don't hold yourself above anybody, you always come down to their level. You came down to my level. No way I could get up to yours.
Oh,
So you came down to mine, and I appreciate that. Born out of heaven.
Yes, amen.
That's good.
We went to Gateway and got into Sunday school class, and Lord, what a blessing. I told her to see that Saturday at Shirley's wedding. What a blessing it was to be in Brother Herb's class. But what he did for Jesse and I more than any other pastor has done before or since was not make us feel like second-class church members because we've been married before.
Yes.
That's right. Amen. How many preachers? And there's a lot of them, I can tell you, because I've faced them. That say, oh no, you've been divorced, you can't do this, you can't do that, you can't do this and the other. Not Brother Herb.
Amen.
He taught a Sunday school class one Sunday, and he says, you know, y'all, I've struggled with this subject for I don't know how many years, you said, long time. And he preached one of the best sermons on folks like us. And I will appreciate that all of my life more than you will ever, ever.
Amen.
And Vicki has been a dear, dear friend.
Yes.
Mary?
Said I was going to do this without crying.
Yeah.
It's hard. Sheila Chandler invited us to church. Brother Herb and Miss Vicki kept us here. And I thank them for a godly marriage, for a godly husband, and to be able to lead my kids to the Lord. That means more to me than he will ever know.
Amen.
We love y'all so much.
Amen. All right, get good up in here and come go ahead, Mr. Lady. What you got?
Well, a few years ago, Brother Herb pulled me aside. He said, I think you need to become a lay pastor at the Cowboy Church. And I told him I'd pray about it. A few weeks later, I come back to him and said, I hadn't felt the calling yet. And so he up and leaves us. And then COVID hits. And everybody else left us. And then he walked Brother Steve, and he calls me a lay leader. So, and I said, well, that sucker got me anyway. I'm proud to be the lay leader of Cowboy.
Amen. Doing a great job.
Yeah, well, you didn't hear proud of that fact, did you? Yes, sir, that's right.
Brother Herb. Vicki, I am glad to have known you, and I'm glad that our relationship one with another has been sweet and has been good. I know you've had a lot of struggles in life. I've listened to the things that you've fat as you've been through, and God has always pulled you through that. Your faith has always helped you up. And it's always a blessing to me to meet godly people. And God sends them to you in your life, not by accident, but to strengthen you. And y'all have strength in me. In my walk with the Lord, and you continue to strengthen me. And that's a good thing. I'm glad that God puts you with people that you can learn things, you know, because we all need to learn things. And I'm glad that God taught you something that you can teach us. I'm grateful. Thank God.
Amen. Yes, ma'am.
I want to say thank you to Brother Herb and Vicki. I cherish her because every time Brother Herb would say something, she would always be the first one to laugh. And she would always be a great sidekick.
Nobody else laughs at my chocolate.
But what I really appreciate is because I really love digging into God's Word and studying it.
Yeah.
And I appreciate it so much because when being a doctor and in all this intelligence of, in God's Word, but him and Vicki had me over to do Bible study one-on-one, and it was deep.
I bet.
Very honorable.
So you were Timothy. I knew I was just Titus.
Yeah.
You were Timothy. Okay. All right.
But anyway, I just for that. And I appreciate that love of that couple, a beautiful team. Thank Jesus.
I just want to say how much these two people made me feel at home the first time I ever came to this church.
Yeah.
I grew up in a very small Southern Baptist church in Good Pine, Louisiana. Not many people know who Good Pine is. It's right outside Gina.
Yep.
And from the first time I walked into here, these people made me feel like I was at home. And Brother Hurd was so supportive of our cowboy fast draw. He was there to give us devotionals and so supportive of everything we do with Cowboy Fast Draw, and we love them both for it.
Amen. Mike?
Yeah, one thing, Brother Hurd, I enjoyed all your sermons that you have. You preached here, everything I've heard, and then I noticed you called me over to the side and say, Mike, I like the way you play the drums. I enjoy your drum music in the church. And I said, thank you. I appreciate that, Brother Earth. And Miss Vicki, you too. And everything. I sure do.
Amen.
Good
job, Mike. Yes.
So one thing that stuck with me is he said right before he left that he was worried he didn't reach young people. Well, I'm younger, I'm not young, but I'm younger. He reached me, he reached my little boy. He got to baptize my little boy right before he left, and he reached my daughter. He came to the hospital the day I had my daughter.
Wow.
And that meant more than he will ever realize.
Yeah.
And I just appreciate them more than they will ever know.
Thank you. I really appreciate, you know, my nephew just about drowned a couple years ago. He was at the hospital, you know, every day, you know. He didn't wear his cowboy hat. He really brought that little boy back. I thank him for that.
Oh, man.
Wow. Wait a minute.
Y'all that know Kenny Nugent know that when Kenny Nugent messes up, he messes up. I'm talking about Alexander Native Town Talk in the KLB Channel 5 News. Like messes up. And I had just started coming here, you know, and Brother Ethan had asked me to be on the praise team. And, you know, I was just loving the church. And then news came out, hit the papers, television, that I missed. And Brother Aiden and Brother Herb over in the office and told them, I said, look, we'll give y'all a heads up. We're fixing to come down the pike. You know, that people are going to be coming to you to tell them about me. And what Brother Hurts here and Brother Aiden, over that. We got your back.
Wow.
If they come to you, to us, we got your back. And Brother Hurts, you know, said, God has forgiven you. All your friends have forgiven you. So don't worry about it. And not to material. What that means.
Amen. Tonight, and I don't believe it is perfect effort. Perfect effort. We are in John chapter 12. I ask you to stand. We'll read just a couple of verses. John chapter 12. And we're going to start reading verse 1. Then 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus was one who had been dead, whom he had raised from the dead. And there they made him supper, and Martha served. But Lazarus was one of those who sat at the table with him. Then Mary took a pound of very costly oil of spikenard, anointed the feet of Jesus, wiped his feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the fragrance of the oil. And one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, who would betray him, said, "Why was this fragrant oil not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor?" This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief and had the money box and used to take what was put in it. But Jesus said, "Let her alone. She has kept this for the day of my burial. For the poor you have with you always, but me you do not have always." Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for your many blessings, and we thank you for Dr. Herb and Miss Vicki. And thank you, God, that they're able to be with us tonight. Thank you, God, for the investment that they made here at Cowboy Church. We pray that you would be with them and bless them in the days to come. Bless our time together in your word tonight, for I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
You guys can be seated. All right, it's 7:56. We're going to be done at 7:05. Here's a 9-minute sermon. Right? I know y'all are believing, but just sit there and shut up and watch. All right? Here's what we got. We got Jesus coming up right to the very end of his life, coming up right to that next to the last week, that last week right before he's going to die. And he goes to a place that he wants to go to. And you can please believe he's going somewhere where he's got friends, where he's got support, where he's got love, where he's got people that care about him. And so he goes to the house in Bethany that he'd been to so many times before, and he visits with his friends, Martha, Mary, and Lazarus. All I got time to say about Lazarus is he was practicing being undead. Alright? Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
Alright, and all I'm going to say about Martha is Martha was doing what Martha does best. She was serving and getting her done. Right?
Yep.
Now, for those of you in the room that remember the story, Martha was the one that did the supper, did the chores and all that. And Mary was the one that was just a little bit more touchy-feely, but had the sense to know Jesus is in the house, I need to spend time with him, rather than doing the dishes. Well, here's what the Marthas, us Marthas, would say about that. Without us Marthas, you Marys would star-slap to death. Can we just say that tonight? Can we just say that those of us that get her done are taking care of the rest of y'all? All right, then. That's what we're going to say about that. That's all we're going to say. We're going to move on in this 9-minute sermon. We're going to get to Mary. And Mary comes in there, and she just takes this very, very expensive perfume, and she pours it out upon Jesus' feet. She's worshiping him. She's at his feet. She's in what I would call reckless abandon. You know, she don't care. She don't care what anybody thinks about this. She don't care if her hair gets dirty. She don't care if his feet are dirty. She don't care what anybody thinks about it. She's going to demonstrate her love to him. In Mark chapter 14, we find the statement where the lady who anointed him, and Jesus says she's done what she could. It was a perfect effort. And it's absolutely a perfect effort when Mary comes and anoints Jesus and pours this perfume on him and dries his feet with her hair. It's an amazing moment. Only a slave would let her hair down like that. And it was just an amazing moment. Everybody took notice of the perfect effort. Well, I want you to know tonight, that word perfect effort comes out of the movie When the Game Stands Tall. Coach Lattisier, played by Jim Caviezel, who also played Jesus in The Passion of the Christ. He told his football team all the time, "I don't expect you to be perfect. You're not going to be perfect. It's just not going to be. You're not always going to have perfect results. But you can always have perfect effort." As soon as Steve's ears heard that, I knew that was a Christian thing. I knew that was a God thing. I knew that was a Christ thing. A perfect effort. I'm just telling you tonight, let me tell you where we're headed on the last minute of this sermon. Here's where we're headed. We expect a perfect effort because God expects a perfect effort.
Amen.
Each and every one of us. If you come to church, if you come to this church to just sit on a bench and to do nothing, you're in the wrong place. This is a place where we want to call you out and say, hey, we want a perfect effort out of you, and we're going to expect it out of the pastor. We're going to expect it out of the lay leader. We're going to expect it out of everybody who works and everybody who leads. But not only that, we're going to expect it out of every person here. A perfect effort. That's what we've got going here. And so I want to tell you very briefly why Jesus deserves your perfect effort. First off, here's why you ought to give him your perfect. Did you just see me get rid of 4 pages of notes? Y'all can thank Dr. Herb that we wasn't here till 9 o'clock tonight. This is it, man. Number one, we need to give God a perfect effort because he expects it. He absolutely does. Where in the world did we get it in our minds, our heads, our ideals, that Jesus is happy with the leftovers of our life? He's not. He's not. He expects your very, very best. He expects your perfect effort. Can I just say this? He deserves your perfect effort.
Amen.
Wow, I could just move on. I'll tell you this and then move on again. He gave you his perfect effort.
Amen.
Did he not?
Amen.
So number one, we need to give God a perfect effort because he expects it. I'll tell you something that really blesses me. Number two, that's all he expects. Now I know you didn't just jump all over that, but you will when you figure out what I just said.
Yes.
That's all he expects. He doesn't ask you to be somebody else. He doesn't ask you to be able to do something else. You know, even with this here, did you know with this here, it's awkward in most churches, is it not? But it's not here. You know why? Because there's not any jealousy. Dr. Herb has got his gifts, his talents. He put a horse to sleep while he's preaching in the arena. I'm not going to look that way. He puts the horses to sleep, and I put the cowboys to sleep, baby. That's what I'm talking about. And if you need that, come on up in here, man. Anyway, I'm going to tell you right now, I don't have to be Dr. Herb. You know, when you were talking about, you know, how many people do you know with doctorates would come out here? And I thought you was going to say, how many people with doctorates would come up in here and pastor this church and preach? And I was going to say, I got one, and I'm doing it, you know. And then you said, well, haul hay and work hard. We don't have the same kind of doctorates. There's two kinds of doctorates. There's a PhD. And let me tell you, the study and the language and the brilliance in that is called piled high and deep. Then there's a doctor's light, and that's what I got. It was hard to get, but, you know, it's a good. And so the thing, I don't have to be Dr. Hurt, and he don't have to be me. I don't have to be Billy Graham. Billy Graham led 3 million people to Christ. Well, I don't have to do that. You know, I just got to be me, and you just got to be you. There's things in church I can't do. I'm telling you right now, I could not be the nursery person. I could take care of one. I don't care how hard that kid's a squalling, I could take care of one. But you give me 2 squalling kids, and I'm a nervous wreck. What you going to do now? What you going to do now? You know what I'm talking about? I couldn't be the treasurer. I could not. I can't keep a checkbook. Can you imagine if I was a treasurer, we had a business meeting, and I said, well, we ain't broke. I don't know if we got money or not. But you see, the whole thing is God doesn't expect you to do things that you can't do. My perfect effort at Cowboy Church. Man, I don't know nothing about that out there. You know, I don't. But my perfect effort is here on Monday nights to preach the word. I love what you said when you said you don't get a whole lot of phone calls. I don't get any phone calls out there. Sorry. This is our leader. He's our pastor. He's leading us. And I'm preaching here and ministering to us when we have needs. And for right now, we're just happy with that. You know?
Amen.
I love to preach. And I love these people. And he's doing a fantastic job.
Amen.
So, we can do our thing. See, God, there's things that I can't do, but God doesn't expect me to do anything that I can't do. Number three, we need to give God a perfect effort because we can. We can. I want you to look at your neighbor and say, whatever you do, tell your neighbor, whatever you do, whatever you do. There's three whatever you do texts that Paul has. Here they are. Therefore, whether you eat or drink,
whatever you do,
do all to the glory of God. Do it for the glory of God. Perfect effort is dedicated to Him. Colossians 3:17. And
whatever you do,
in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. Do it in the name of Jesus. A perfect effort is done right. You know, I'm just one of them kind of guys, when you take out the trash, you ought to do it right.
Amen.
You know, you ought to take out the trash the right way. My first job was as a trash man. Don't knock it. I got paid $5 a day to drive my grandpa's red Chevrolet truck. I was 12 years old. I mean, no driver's license, baby. When you get 11, you can drive, okay?
Green car.
Yeah, that's it. In a green car. It's not rocket. We'll go. Anyway, whatever you do, do your perfect effort. Do it for the Lord. Do everything that you can and do it right. When you dig a ditch, do it right. Do whatever you do as if you're doing it for Christ. And especially when you're at church, do everything you can as well as you can. And finally, and
whatever
you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not to men. Give it everything you've got, Paul says. A perfect effort is a completed effort. I'm not going to give up, I'm not going to give in, and I'm not going to give out. A perfect effort can never be a part-time commitment.
Amen.
You can't be a part-time, commitment and give God a perfect effort. Anything less than a full-time, 168 hours a week, here's my best. Anything less than that, you know, we've been giving a perfect effort, which is never going to be a part-time. I've never understood part-time commitment anyway. Can you just imagine if you told your spouse, you know, I'm going to be faithful to you almost all the time.
Wow.
What's that I see? Oh, that's your clothes burning on the front door, boy. That's what I'm talking about. A perfect effort can never be a partial commitment. You know, you can't tell the football coach, hey, I'm going to play for you, man, and I'm going to do everything I can to help our team win for almost the whole game, but on the last drive, I'm going to play for the other side. That ain't going to work. And you know, and that's what we want to do all the time. Jesus, you got me most of the time, but most of all, I need to belong to the devil. Well, no, you don't.
Amen.
You need to belong to Him. Number four, we do our best in other things. Some of y'all are doing the best you can out there. And you should. You should do the best you can do in everything you do. But if you're going to give your best to anything, you need to give your best to God.
Amen.
You know what? There's people that give their best to false gods.
Come on.
Yeah.
They give their lives for Allah.
Yep.
We need to live our lives for Jesus.
Amen.
Yep. Number five and the final one. When you do your best, it inspires others to do their best. And I'm going to tell you right now, I got two words for you on that one. Dr. Hurd.
Amen.
When you do your best, it inspires others to do their best. When you see a guy doing the best he can to pastor Cowboy Church, it puts a thought in your mind that, whoo, you know, maybe one day that could be me. One day maybe I could do my best. You see, perfect effort in everything you do. Across Brandon Church, we're not asking you to be perfect people. We know better. We know none of us are perfect. And we're all far, far, far from it.
Amen.
We're not asking for perfect results. We know there's going to be mess-ups. We're not asking for perfect outcomes. But we're asking every person for a perfect effort. From our staff, our leaders, every person, a perfect effort. Amen?
Amen.
Man, what a blessing you guys are. We're going to have a time of prayer.